Hello, and welcome to the state we're in. I'm Melanie Plenda. This spring, educators and families around the state scrambled to make the quick pivot from in-person classes to remote learning for Granite State students, as they now all prepare for what the fall will look like for education in New Hampshire schools. The Granite State News Collaborative, of which New Hampshire PBS is a partner, is launching a series that takes a look at lessons learned during the remote experiment and what plans, if any, are in place for improving remote learning should it be needed in the fall. Joining me now are the two lead reporters on that project, independent data journalist Hillary Niles and contributing researcher John Bassett. Welcome to you both and thanks for being here.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you very much.
Hillary, let's start with you. Give us an overview of what you looked at for this project and what you learned about how the state and individuals were working remote learning.
Absolutely. Well, the project came about because we knew that remote learning had been a huge disruption for the education system throughout New Hampshire this spring in the emergency circumstances. And we also anticipated that it would likely remain on the table for the fall for schools that were either concerned about safety or for budgetary constraints, decided that they wouldn't be able to open, or for schools that were pursuing a hybrid model. Or heaven forbid, if there's another spike in the virus and all of the school buildings have to be shut down again. So knowing that it had been such a challenge and knowing that it was still very much still a part of the conversation, we felt like it was important to really assess how remote learning had gone, again, when it was rolled out under these crisis circumstances, and get a sense of what schools were taking away, what kind of lessons they were learning about how that had gone in the spring so that they can make it better in the future when they hopefully will have a little bit of time to plan for it. So that was the goal of the project. And a really important aspect of how we went about doing it was to make sure that we were reporting on schools and school districts from a wide cross-section of the state. We wanted large and small school districts. We wanted rich and poor, we wanted rural and urban, we wanted single school districts or multi-school districts, and really just to paint as broad a picture as we could of the varied landscape of education ways, therefore, that remote learning played out in all of those different scenarios.
And Hillary, what were some of the challenges that you discovered these districts were facing?
Right. Well, really, the challenges are not new. They're varied and they're not new. As I was saying, you know, some rich and poor, like some school districts have more challenges with funding their school budgets than others. Some schools have higher population of English language learners as students. Some schools are, you know, have historically struggled with proficiency and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So the full range of challenges that schools already were dealing with, they were still dealing with through remote learning. And so we should take a look at how that, how those different factors created different experiences in the schools mm-hmm. around the state. Tradition of local control in New Hampshire was really very apparent in the course of this reporting because it's so interesting now is, for example, as schools are starting to announce their plans for the fall, it's fascinating to look at the varied responses that they have. There are a lot of the same elements of trying to plan for anything, but every school is sort of doing it in its own way. And so it's interesting to see how the local control allows schools to respond to a crisis more nimbly with whatever resources they have, and addressing their specific challenges rather than a one-size-fits-all solution. At the same time, it was really interesting to see the challenge that the tradition of local control creates for schools dealing with a crisis. Because in my interviews with superintendents and principals and teachers and from districts around the state, I was getting a lot of responses that when I was asking about how they figured out how to, you know, pivot to remote learning on a dime this spring, really a lot of the school districts were inventing their own wheels. And so it was interesting to see that there wasn't in the beginning a lot of cross-district sharing. The state did create a clearinghouse of resources for remote learning. And so that was like an online sort of central clearinghouse of resources for teachers and parents and students. And it was also interesting to see some networks, existing networks strengthen and some new networks form. So it was still a little bit ad hoc, but a little bit less ad hoc than just one individual teacher happening to call a teacher that she knew in a different district to say, I'm struggling, or I don't know how to reach my ELL families. What are you doing? A lot of it was ad hoc, but it was neat to see the development of some networks that are strengthening the ties across districts now.
Sure. And John, let's pick up on one of those challenges and sort of the responses to it. One thing I know that you looked at is the idea of digital distress. And can you explain that a little bit and how that factored into this project?
Yeah. So at the beginning of remote learning, there was a lot of conversation around where internet is available in the state, where kids are going to be able to access online learning. So when we looked into that, we were trying to find where in the state kids are going to have problems. And we ended up using an index called the Digital Distress Index that measures a few proxy statistics, like from the census data, how many subscriptions for the internet are available in a certain area, have been taken up in a certain area, or how many devices are used within a certain family. But the reason why we ended up on the Digital Distress Index is that this is a surprisingly difficult phenomenon to track using the data. So in the southern part of the state, it's easy for many of us to get online, and it's easy to forget that there are some parts of the state where that access is not so easy. This is an issue now because the governor is currently offering funding to expand broadband coverage. So where should the state spend it? If the goal is to provide broadband to rural areas, where is the greatest need? And unfortunately, this is actually difficult to find out. And this is a nationwide issue. It's not just a New Hampshire issue. But there are no good data sets for where that help you see where in the state the received internet speed is below broadband, which is an indicator of the strength of the internet across the state. So there were previous projects that were supported by the state that looked into this. But as Carol Miller, who's the director of broadband technology at the state of New Hampshire, confirmed earlier this year, no data is currently being collected about received internet speeds across the state. There is a new survey that went out recently that asks people to report when they have issues, but there's no systematic survey that's been done. So we looked into this issue just because we were trying to get the data to help us to shape our reporting the way that Hillary described. But this is an issue that is going to stick around for a while, and other researchers will probably want to look into it in the fall.
And I know, John, another thing that you looked at was learning time. So can you talk to us about, how you approached that topic and kind of the importance of it? What were you looking at there and what did you discover?
Yeah. So one of the topics we were looking at was attendance policies. This was both how a school defined what counted as attendance during remote learning, but also how the schools tried to keep in touch with their students when they went remote. So in order to do this, we identified a few key districts across the state, ones that traditionally have had very high rates of attendance. So we found a big school and large school that matched that description. That was Sunapee on the small end and Bedford on the high end, on the large end. We also found schools that have a relatively low level of attendance in the past, and that's Franklin on the low end, and Manchester, the largest school district in the state, on the high end. And within those four districts, we looked to see how they defined attendance and how they tried to keep in track with students. So there's lots of attention has been given to Chromebooks and access to internet, as I was describing before. That's clearly a critical part of how many schools in the state kept in touch with their students. But in the course of reporting, we found some other issues as well. So attendance policies vary dramatically across the state. Some districts like Franklin counted everyone as present by default. Whereas other districts like Bedford and Manchester actually tried to keep daily attendance. So this means that the data that we're going to get that's going to be published in the fall about attendance during remote learning is going to be really unreliable. It's going to beyond anecdotal evidence from educators, it's going to be really hard to know which schools actually did a good job of keeping in touch with their students. One thing that did come up in these anecdotal interviews, though, was that guidance counselors and social workers played a critical role in many districts' attempts to keep in touch with students. So Franklin and Manchester exemplified this, but this was true in each of the four districts that I talked to. In Franklin, they have a very low history of attendance. Franklin High School has the highest annual dropout rate in the state, and the district-wide attendance rate is one of the state's lowest. But in part because Franklin had Chromebooks already, and they made a very quick shift to remote learning once the governor announced it in mid-March, I believe, the district was in a good position to then take advantage of its guidance counselors, who, because they're used to having a lot of kids who need special attention in their community, they apparently did a really great job reaching out to students. And as a result, Superintendent Dan Legallo said that there was not a spike in truancies or students that were really dropping off the map. And I thought that was really extraordinary, given that Franklin has a history of challenges keeping in touch with students, that in this specific context, they seem to do really well. And we saw this in Manchester also to a much larger extent, because they do not have Chromebooks there and for every student, and really relied on the social workers, creative solutions from the staff and teachers to keep in touch with students.
And John, first to you and then to Hillary, this is a question for both of you. You know, in the areas that you looked at, what were school officials talking about when it came to plans? Like they obviously there were some lessons learned. Were there things that they were making plans to sort of implement changes at this point to any way that they did remote learning, or what were you finding there?
So some of the schools are going to return to in-person learning, which means that the attendance policy issues that I've been describing are essentially been bypassed. So Sunapee is going to return to a fully in-person model. They've announced their reopening plans, and this is what they plan to do. Bedford, for whom attendance policies, according to Superintendent Michael Fournier, attendance policies were basically a non-issue there, because they had such strong community engagement and had Chromebooks for every student, they were able to take daily attendance. So they are planning to buy new Chromebooks for students who didn't have, some of whom needed them to be provided by the district, but they're not expecting very many changes. For the others, for Manchester, their reopening plan is not out yet, but because they are expecting to involve some amount of remote learning, they are also expected to buy more Chromebooks. But none of the four districts I talked to are planning to hire additional guidance counselors and social workers. In lieu of that, some of them are offering additional trainings to their teachers, because they're really the front line on keeping in touch with students and identifying the most at-risk students.
And Hillary, how about you? What were some of the plans that you heard? Were there any districts that were planning on making changes to the way they had done things, or what, based on what they had learned?
Yes, changes, absolutely. And I will say that it's been a Herculean effort for the school administrators and educators to figure out how to make improvements to remote learning to the extent that it will or might be used, at the same time that they're planning for figuring out how to reopen their schools as quickly as possible. So they're sort of like challenged to reflect on the last crisis while they're simultaneously putting out the next fire already. That said, the conversations that I had with administrators and educators across the board definitely surfaced a lot of reflection that had gone on along the way. And there was a lot of learning throughout the course of the spring, identifying challenges that they know they need to improve on if they, you know, are going to roll out remote learning again. But also a lot of people reflected on ways that they had been able to improve even within the spring. And so challenges that they had had early on, they had sort of figured out some improved processes for as they went. One thing that I will say is pretty universal is focusing on professional development for teachers to make sure that teachers are more comfortable with technology, because the more comfortable the teachers are with the technology, the more they'll be able to assist the students and families being comfortable with the technology. So lots of professional development on the technology side, and also lots of professional development and attention being paid to social and emotional well-being, how to look for cues and respond to students who are showing signs of anxiety, or you know, some students sort of, some teachers talked about students that sort of retreated into a shell that were normally pretty gregarious, and that was one of the surprising developments. So we're focusing on social and emotional well-being and training up to learn to recognize what might be some new signs of distress there. And definitely monitoring progress is something that across the board, every school knows they're going to have to figure out how to do a better job going forward.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, John and Hillary.
You're welcome. Thanks for having us, Melanie.
Thank you very much for having us.
As Hillary mentioned, this has been a Herculean task for New Hampshire school administrators. One of those administrators who shared her district's experience in the series is Julie King, superintendent of Berlin's public schools. Welcome, Julie. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Looking back to the spring, what was one lesson you learned that is informing your fall plans?
I would say that the lesson we've learned is we did a great job jumping into remote learning. Not that we had much of a chance, a chance to do otherwise. But we know we can do better. Teachers have been working hard this summer and working on their curriculum, making more flexible going into this coming school year. For sure, we as a district are one-to-one, and students had computers, Chromebooks, and teachers are used to using Google Classroom. Many of them are familiar with that and comfortable with that, but we have some work to do moving the whole school year where we know we will possibly have to flex in and out of remote learning.
And what are your plans for this fall? Has Berlin decided whether to do a hybrid model, in-person, remote? Do you know yet?
We've certainly been working hard on putting our heads together to come up with a reasonable and the most consistent plan that we can heading into the school year. The official plan will go to the board on Thursday night, August 6th, for a vote. Right now, it looks a little bit different at the elementary level than the middle high school level. We're looking at middle high being on-site instruction 3 days of the week. And those that choose a pathway of remote learning will have remote instruction with the same teachers on Mondays, and then on Fridays they'll have some call-in office hours. At the elementary level, we're waiting on the final decision from the building administrators. You know, that this has really been a heavy lift for everybody, and as I like to say, we're looking for the best of the bad plans, because really there is no great alternative in this. But we're looking for something that accommodates the most families and our staff, of course. So at the elementary level, it will be some form of choice for remote learning and on-site learning.
And what are some of the biggest challenges you see specifically with the start of the school year? What are the biggest challenges?
I think the challenge that we're facing is one that everyone is facing in society, whether it's schools or businesses, is just the day-to-day uncertainty and the ever-changing circumstances and the inundation of information and not knowing what to trust information. Very difficult to make decisions based on that. So the uncertainty weighs heavy with staff and with families. We know that opening schools, reopening schools, is a divisive topic with people all across the country. And we're trying to find the best way to do it, to make everybody comfortable and accommodate people's fear levels and people's family situations, staff concern. So that has been the biggest challenge of all of this, and finding that path forward. I'm sure once we get going and get into it, we'll find a rhythm quickly. We expect to have some interruptions and delays in the learning process as we go, but planning ahead and being able to anticipate those things is key.
Yeah. Well, and one of those things I'm sure is, you know, keeping your staff and everyone in the building, the children, all safe. How has that process been this summer, trying to prepare just for that, for that in-person part of instruction?
In the North Country, we've had relatively few cases of COVID. So that has made things a little bit easier. But as I said, the inundation of media and just having so much information out there, whether it's on the news or social media, people talking, of course, our families and our staff are just as fearful. And, you know, we have to take that into account in our planning. We're hoping to keep the community spread, of course, extremely low, but we know with the opening of everything up here in the North Country with tourism, you know, there's kind of this feeling that it could break at any moment. When there's an announcement of a positive case in town, or two positive cases, we all wonder, is this going to be it? Is it coming? So alleviating people's fears has been very difficult. And the safety of our students, our families, our entire community is so important to us. In the North Country, we don't have the resources, you know, medically to handle large outbreaks. And of course, our population is small, so we wouldn't expect to have the same level of outbreaks that the major cities are having. But the fear is still there. And so that has been challenging to overcome that.
That health and well-being piece, you know, what we've heard from administrators and teachers and families all over the state is once kids do go back, they have been through, you know, sort of a traumatic experience and with this disruption. And how are you looking at handling that, like addressing those sorts of fears and concerns that they have? Are you working on plans to sort of address that as the need for that may increase this year?
Mm-hmm. The emotional aspect is definitely a concern of ours. Saw that in the spring when we moved in this direction. Our families, our students, and especially our staff, emotionally as citizens, it hit us all hard, and the fear and the uncertainty, you know, not knowing what was going to happen. So I wonder about our students and this generation and what this interruption in their lives will bring. I know ultimately people are resilient and children are resilient. So I'm hoping that it's not a huge hurdle and a huge change to this generation. In place, we'll have some social emotional learning through our guidance counselors, and we are the district to have been part of some previous grant projects that tied us in with community agencies for counseling. So we expect to continue those services and have that available for not only students but for staff. We just need to all be watching out for one another and checking in often to make sure that everybody is doing okay emotionally.
Well, Julie King, Superintendent of Berlin Schools, thank you for joining us and good luck this fall.
Thank you so much.
After bringing Unity Health and local school board members together, Superintendent King said the district has decided to require masks, although for those who don't wish to wear a mask, a remote option will be available. This comprehensive series on remote learning is available at news outlets across the Granite State. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.